Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Joe. Oh, goddamn, this is hard. Oh, guys, welcome to. Oh my.
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of. Andrew Mo Money. Hi, my name is Andrew Mo. It's great to see you guys. It's really, really a pleasure to make your acquaintance. This is Professor Meatball. He is a PhD doctorate from the University of Cornell. And today we're going to talk about how accurate is Joma's video, 5 tips for getting a data science job back in March of 2018 to today, the 2020 and 2021, especially post-pandemic, currently in the pandemic landscape. My goal of this video is so that you can answer questions like, are these skills still applicable in the year 2020 and 2021? Can I trust Joma for his Joma class, which is still running? I'm not affiliated with any way, but you know, he is trying to create resources for you as a data scientist. And how do I smash the like button and the subscribe button if I'm new so that we can defeat the algorithm together? If you hit the like button right now, I'm gonna show you a picture of Meatball. So darn cute. Are you ready? It's gonna be right here, right there, as soon as you click that button. Thank you. Oh, you didn't do it yet? Okay, there you go. Without further ado, let's jump into what I think about this video from Joma Tech.
I had to remove my day in a life video, the one that got me most of my views. I had to take it down because I violated some policies.
So Joma, also known as Jonathan Jemias Teckerson, he is a data scientist, or was a data scientist working for Facebook. You can tell he is still filming technically on Facebook's campus. It is just directly outside his campus on the trail. And one of the things that he started working on recently is education. So he's breaking into the space of actually helping people become data scientists. So that's admirable of him.
But today we're going to be talking about something different. We're going to be talking about how to get a data science job at a large company like Friendster or MySpace, something like that. First of all, what is data science?
See, you can tell that this video is very old because he's still talking about Friendster and MySpace. Those companies are like 3 years old, 4, 5, really old for the .com era.
Is that still what it's called?
A lot of people have, misconceptions about data science. So if you do, I would suggest you to check this video I made with Engineered Truth.
That's funny. Engineered Truth just recently sold his channel last month. He is now called, whoever bought his channel is now called Honest Careers, I think. Well, whatever it's called, that video might still be up. I think it's still the best performing video.
All right, so let's get to it, to the 5 tips on how to land a data science job. Number 1 tip, do an internship and have a technical degree. How I got my first hands-on experience on data science was my internship. And I did my internship in a large untitled company.
Oh, he didn't have to censor himself for that. First tip, do an internship and have a technical degree. Well, I have to really agree with this latter half. Doing an internship is not easy to acquire. Especially if you're coming from a place that, you need experience to get more experience. Joma's going to talk about exactly how an internship provides you a springboard, basically a proof of work for how you can become a viable candidate for other companies because you have the ability to say, I did this job correctly inside the landscape that essentially emulates what I would do as a full-time employee.
So here are some examples of good degrees to have. CS, just engineering in general, like system engineering, maybe even environmental engineering, just anything with the word engineering in it, they would deem it as technical and they will give you an interview. All right, second tip.
I'm not quite done with the first half of what he said yet. He's listed a bunch of technical degrees. Now that's actually a very good idea. Being able to have a technical degree puts you on a level playing field with other computer scientists and software engineering majors. One of the main ideas that he's putting out here is that if you have a software engineering or equivalent major, you are now someone who is able to put himself at the front of the line when it comes to proof of work. Once again, it's about proof of work. Now, if you're curious about how to get an internship, it involves the same cycle of trying to become competitive through personal projects. Especially if it's your first internship that you're trying to get, you have to really try and build out your portfolio of personal projects. And I can send you down a couple of links for playlists that Kenji and Data Professor have created for their personal projects.
No matter how fancy your, you know, Python is and stuff like that, in the end, usually most companies set up their infrastructure so that you query data using SQL.
Learning SQL is really important. Learning SQL is a language that I believe you can learn in 24 hours and master in 7 days. That's the initiative that I'm trying to build out from 60 seconds to data science. It essentially means that SQL is the bread and butter of most data science interview cycles. And if not, probably one of the only languages you'll use as an entry-level data scientist for the first couple of months.
Usually, most companies set up their infrastructure so that you query data using SQL. Why? Because it's an easy language.
It's not really because it's an easy language. It certainly is straightforward, so that helps. But the reason why SQL is used all over the place is because it scales. It's a structured query language. You can use SQL to query a data set of just 3 or 4 columns and 3 or 4 rows, but you can also use that same query to query something that has terabytes of data. This is usually something that older languages, even Python, have to consider when they're thinking about time complexity. You can make a quick and dirty hack that gets you something along the lines of what you're looking for, just as long as the input or the data doesn't scale and doesn't become humongous. However, SQL isn't quite the same. It's the same language that is used in big data. So you can imagine BigQuery is actually directly related to the simple SQL functions that you're writing on a day-to-day basis as an entry-level data scientist.
And then what you do is you have to write queries for that. Yeah, I'm not gonna go through the answer, but you should. That would give you an idea of what kind of query you should run. Tip number 3, learn about success metrics and tracking metrics.
Oh, that's so important. I actually really agree with Joma in this sense, in that the metrics that you follow in terms of the entry-level like product landscape is incredibly important. If you don't have an idea of what metrics your industry, whatever job you're trying to get into, you can just start breaking it down as a core user. The easiest way that you can think about it is take out your phone, look at which apps that you use most often, and then think about what you do on that app, from login to scrolling to interacting to logging out. From there, you can start learning metrics like total session time, like how long do you actually scroll and then click out of the app. How often do you have impressions, like photos from your friends or ads from an advertiser, and you click through it, the impressions click-through rate, and how often do you log in on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, that is the daily active user rate and the weekly active user rate. You see, these are metrics that you can immediately start thinking about through each application, and e-commerce applications are going to be different, marketplace applications are going to be different. Learning about these metrics is going to help you a ton in interviews.
It's important because when you become a data scientist, you will be the expert on your team on data.
This is really only true for Facebook. This is that kombucha. But you don't have to be an extrovert to be a data scientist. I think that's one of the most dangerous ideas that data scientists have, to be this kind of go-getter, product manager type of person. This is only one type of data scientist, and that's the main reason why data science is such a tricky term, because it ultimately ends up being data science is now a blanket term for 4 different kinds of jobs. One that is closer to the analyst side, where you are making business inference for barely any statistics, but mostly SQL-based, visualization-based work. And then the other 2 jobs, which are actually plugging in the back end for the data pipeline, more of a data engineering job. And then finally, someone who is actually tuning the models, more of the machine learning engineer job.
So what are the tracking metrics? So that would be, for example, let's think about it. I want to know if they're actually watching a lot of, you know, videos. So tracking metrics can be watch time per active user, and then, or maybe just watch time in general.
Joma's right now going through a pretty lengthy rabbit hole of talking about exactly the kind of success metrics and tracking metrics for this hypothetical. I would say if you are curious about this, I will leave a link down below. And you can also look into how different data scientists have walked through interviews of entire metrics. I think that's going to be a little more helpful if you want to be in the technical sense. But the way that I practically laid out for you is a behavioral hack. If you can go into apps that you've already used and then imagine yourself as a core user, and then just think from the point of view of the salesman of the app. You know, the product manager is essentially the owner of the lemonade stand for a specific feature. If someone is specifically taking care of the YouTube like button, then all he really cares about is how often you use it, how at what rate do you use it, for what videos do you use, and how similar are you to other users who also use that feature. If you can keep those three things in mind, I think you have a good sense for most metrics and where they can come from.
And then the next question, after asking like how would you, you know, define your success metrics, it would be how do you test it? Okay, so here's one thing you need to know. You need to know about A-B tests. You need to know about control groups and experimental groups. And
A-B testing is going to be a big kicker for most people in interviews, and I'm going to give you like a 30-second rundown right now. The main idea behind A-B tests is that you have to understand that what you're trying to see is a difference between one group and another that isn't due to random chance. That's it. If I take two groups of chickens from the exact same chicken pen, where are they from? Chicken land. If I take two groups of chickens from the exact same chicken land and I try to measure their differences, they're going to be different, at least in a small bit, because of random chance. So if you want to conduct an A-B test and we hypothesize that there is a real difference between these two groups because of something we're doing, changing a feature, flipping something on, flipping something off, then we want to be able to make that rigorous test between these two groups. To pass interviews about A-B tests, you have to ask three questions. One, you have to ask about sampling. How are you going to sample? Are you going to use stratified, clustered sampling? Are you going to be careful how you sample from demographics such as age and gender, but also from rural versus non-rural communities, users of a specific political leaning, users with a specific purchase history? You have to think about exactly how you are divvying up the sampling process. Two, you have to ask a question about the network effects inherent in this process. If a Facebook-like entity tries to flip on a feature for a specific group of isolated individuals, people are gonna know. So what is the risk of running an experiment too long for network effects to start interacting with your isolated groups, but run the experiment long enough so that the novelty effect isn't the only thing that you're measuring? And that, in 10 seconds, is just when people see a new feature, they are probably more likely to try to interact with it, even though they might not want to. And three, how significant are the results? Now, this comes back to p-values and confidence intervals, not including the null value, but if that was all too complicated, the main point is, can we prove that the results that we see are actually due to not random chance? It's a lot of not-nots in there, but remember that our chicken example. If the two groups of chickens that we selected from the same group of chickens have a small difference, that should be due to random chance. And we would not be able to be confident that we have evidence that these two groups are actually different.
And you need to visualize the data because you need to communicate them later.
Learning visualization skills is nice, but it will almost never come up on an interview. So the only times I've ever had to prove my visualization skills was during a take home. And for that, you can always just Google. So there you go.
All right, number five. You have to learn to communicate really, really well, because the whole point of a data scientist is to communicate their findings.
Communication is incredibly important. And once again, I have to go back to what he said about extroverts. You do not have to seek joy from interacting with people to be a good communicator. To be a good communicator, you have to empathize. You have to come from a point where you are not exactly sure what the other person is coming from. You have to be able to drop down your technical knowledge to a baseline so that you can start making powerful analogies, you can start making clear concept bridging statements so that people can follow you and track wherever you are going, and make sure that your statements about statistical truth and rigor are not misconstrued, because that can be costly down the line for business stakeholders. Mainly, talk good so people don't make mistakes, because you're big brain.
All right, so yeah, so that's about it. That's five tips on how to land a data science job at an untitled large company. And yeah, I hope that was useful.
It was great. It's amazing how little 2 years has actually changed the data science landscape in terms of the skills necessary. And that's because, you know, data science has had a long and rigorous past, and the most important three takeaways from this video I hope you remember is: one, focus on skills that are gonna help you pass the interview so that you can get your very first internship or job so that you can get more experience, because you're gonna learn 95% of what you need to know from your first job. So don't learn extraneous skills like how to finely tune a hyperparameter for neural networks or different models, and don't learn extraneous skills like visualization software. You don't have to go buy a Tableau license just so that you can learn it, so you can say, I know visualization skills. Secondly, make sure that you don't skimp the statistical stuff when it comes to A/B tests. That's gonna be asked, it's gonna be on the test, and you're gonna have to know a little bit about how to communicate that to a five-year-old. Explain like I'm five, statistical concepts about A/B tests. And then three, make sure that you learn to communicate. And if that involves you starting a YouTube channel, talking to a camera, you know, explaining to a rubber duck, right, talking to a roommate or your best fluffy friend, that can be really helpful, because you need to be able to learn how to open your mouth and start something sensible every single time. I hope that was helpful. I hope that was great. If you wanted me to interact with more YouTubers online, or specifically just Joma, make sure to write a comment down below. This is part of a 30-day challenge. I'm trying to upload every single day. Hector Elizondo, my roommate, is helping out a ton. Shout out to him. He is really my biggest supporter. I really want to thank Professor Meatball for being patient with me. And I want to thank you for supporting content just like this. Follow me on Instagram. I really need the social validation. Check me out on TikTok. I make short form content there. And for the sake of you, go ahead and check out an Audible book or get 4 free stocks in the month of December for Weeble. As always, but not for forever, I'll see you guys next time. Peace. Hey guys, well, because you're big brain.